All right, so we're going to pick up with chapter 2 first as a reminder of chapter 1. We saw in chapter 1 there's personal preparation for wisdom, and that included five goals for the reader of the book of Proverbs, different types of readers and sources of wisdom. From the fear of the Lord is one source of wisdom, and our parents are another source of wisdom, and all of us had good parents who believed in this. Believed in discipline and believed in training and so on. So that's a huge advantage for us. You know, it really is. You look at young people who don't have that and they just struggle in a lot of areas that an 18 to 20 to 22 year old shouldn't struggle in. And so be very thankful for that. I know you are. So there's, go ahead. Yeah, wait till you get older. Wait till 20 years from now when all of you are out of the house and married with kids and doing the same things that your parents used to do. It gets pretty funny because we all get together and we're like, yeah, I remember this. And Dad's just sitting over in the corner kind of laughing, you know. You know, he's watching all of us do what he used to do. You know, come here and sit down next to me. You know, when all the cousins are together and they're playing, and one of them has to come and sit down next to Dad. Oh, that's the worst thing. And I remember Dad used to do that to us. Oh, and he'd be up there talking and forget about us, you know. And we'd be like, you know, and finally you're tapping his leg. Can I go now? No, you're being bad. Sit down. Oh, here's another 10 minutes wasted. And now I'm doing it too, you know. It's really good. It's really funny. Personal preparation for wisdom, identifying wrong influences and heeding wisdom. We talked about the cry of wisdom. That's a shout, a shrill sound, like a help, urgent. I need help. Wisdom cries out and wants the simple to listen and wants the wise to listen. But fools despise that cry of wisdom. All right, we're going to pick up now in chapter 2 with the conditions of wisdom. That's what I entitle chapter 2, the conditions of wisdom. And I've got a page of notes that we'll look at concerning this. First of all, I'm only dividing this into two sections. So first of all, I want you to see in verses 1 through 9, we're going to look at knowing God and understanding righteousness. Knowing God and understanding righteousness. These are the first 9 verses that we'll be looking at here. And we don't exactly look at them in order, but we compare amongst these 9 verses. We'll look at all of them, some individually and some kind of as a group. So, knowing God and understanding righteousness. Now, here's what I put on the board. These are my 3 main points underneath this. I know, weird points, but that's the way it's kind of set up. If you will, lists out a whole bunch of different things in chapter 2. Look at verse number 1. My son, if thou wilt, receive my words, hide my commandments, so that thou incline thine ear, apply thine heart, criest after knowledge, liftest up thy voice for understanding, seekest her as silver, searchest for her as for hid treasures, then you will, there's my next point, then thou shalt. You see how it's set up? So that's verse 6? No, verse 5. Then shalt thou understand and find, for the Lord giveth wisdom, out of his mouth cometh knowledge and understanding. He layeth up sound wisdom, he keepeth the paths of the just. Sorry, I skipped one. He's a buckler, he preserves the way of his saints. Then shalt thou understand righteousness and judgment and equity, yea, every good path. All right, so let me give you, we're going to start out here first with if thou wilt, if you will, receive his words, receive God's words. Now remember the word receive, we talked about the word receive already once. This is not talking about, the waitress comes by and sets a plate down in front of you and you receive it. Right? This is talking about as you consume it. right? Remember we talked about that? So it's not just receiving it, it's really receiving it. It's ingesting it, it's digesting it. My wife and I went out to La Peep in Valpo last week on Valentine's Day morning, and they're known for their breakfast. Whew, crepes, if you like crepes, oh, it's fabulous. So as soon as they bring that out and I'm smelling it, and they set it down in front of me, I received it, but I didn't really receive it until I received it, until I ate it. It was delicious. Receive his word. So God's words should be like that. They should be ingested and taken in. And just like I preached about, if you really believe it, you'll receive it all the way. Secondly, hide his commandments. Hide God's commands with thee. Now, when I think of hiding something, we kind of think of keeping something from somebody else. Okay, if I'm hiding something from one of my sisters or brothers because I don't want them to get it. But that's not what this is talking about. This is talking more about what you would do with something that is valuable so that it doesn't get, so that it doesn't go missing. So I have something that's valuable. I won't ask you what's valuable because hopefully you have it hidden and you don't want me to find out. But if I had gold or silver, okay, I would hide that. In other words, I would, you know, I won't tell you where it is or if I have anything. Why not do you, obviously, because yeah, I'm giving it away. But if I had a lockbox, not a dorm lockbox, but a heavy-duty lockbox, and it's stashed away, that's hiding it. Why am I hiding it? Because I never look at it? No, I do look at it. Is it because I don't want, because I'm never going to use it? No. It's because I don't want the wrong person to come in and get it. So I don't want it to go missing. And that's the way we ought to treat God's commandments, is that we're not hiding them because we want to get them out of the way. We're hiding them because they're that important and they're that vital to us that we say, I don't want these to ever go away. And so we store them in a place where they're safe and secure and useful. You know, it's kind of hard to think of those together, but that's the way it is with the commandments of God. Hide them. Third, cry after knowledge. If thou criest after knowledge. Verse number 3. So we already looked at that word cry, to shout after. When Saul was in the cave and he came out and he's walking away, the Bible says David came out and yelled after him. If you cry after knowledge. Fourth, lift up your voice for understanding. I think I told you, maybe I didn't tell you, but I recently had this conversation. She often asked me, why are you talking so loud? It's because I really am excited about something. I found a good deal yesterday, and I was telling my wife about it, and I couldn't believe it was a good deal. And she said, no, why are you being so loud? I said, because I'm excited about it. That's the way it is. Lift up your voice for understanding. It's easy to lift up my voice for a good deal. Or it's easy to lift up my voice because I'm really believe in something, you know, or whatever. But lift up your voice for understanding. Get excited about it. You know, it's that important. Next, if thou seekest her as silver, seek wisdom as silver. If thou seekest her as silver. Okay, seeking after something. How do you seek after silver? Anybody ever done that? I certainly have not. But I can imagine that if you're seeking for silver, that would require like a silver mine, right? So what do you have to do? You have to invest. You have to put effort and time into it. You have to have a plan. You know, if I was seeking for silver, I'd have no clue where to start. I'm guessing a mountain somewhere. You know, that's not really starting. How do you set up a system? See, I'd have no idea. But if I worked in it for a while, I would then say, you know what, I know how to do that. I can start my own company maybe, whatever. If thou seekest, what's the point? In the Bible, with the word of God and wisdom, it's specifically talking about wisdom, that we ought to know our way about it. We ought to have a plan to get it and lay out a systematic plan to retrieve wisdom like we would find silver. Seek after wisdom like you're going after silver. And search us for her as for hid treasures. Search for wisdom like it's hidden treasure. That's the sixth thing. That if you'll do these things, then the next point, then you will do other things, or you'll receive other things. So search for wisdom like a hidden treasure. I've lost things before that I knew were in the house. I knew they were in the house. You wait till, I'm sure you've done it too some, but man, when you got your own house and all kinds of stuff and file cabinets. And okay, I know what I need. I remember one time I couldn't find my passport. You know, and all along I'm getting ready to go on a trip and I said, you know, I know my passport. I got my passport. Oh yeah, that's all set. I never even thought about it much again. Finally, I go to where I thought the passport should have been and it wasn't there. And I'm almost ready to leave. And so now all of a sudden you kind of freak out. I have to have this passport. What do? Man, you go through everything. You stay up late. You get up early. What's the point? Search for wisdom like you're going for something you have to have. What are you going to do? Just you do whatever it takes to get it. Stay up late, get up early. Seeking after wisdom like it's a hidden treasure. All right. If you'll do those things, then thou shalt, verse number 5, understand the fear of the Lord. Not just know about it. I know that there's fear of the Lord. No, you're going to understand the fear of the Lord. When you are seeking for wisdom like it's the most important thing, excuse me, which it is, in God's eyes, we should seek after wisdom. Then you'll understand the fear of the Lord, because wisdom and God are directly connected. God is wisdom. God is all wise. So as a young person, seek after wisdom. It'll bring you to the fear of the Lord. You'll also find the knowledge of God. What does that mean? Then shalt thou understand the fear of the Lord and find the knowledge of God. How do you find the knowledge of God? What is that referring to?
God's plans for your life.
Yeah, sure. God's plans for your life. God's will. So how do you find God's will? Do you pray for God's will? Well, yes, but more importantly, you seek after wisdom. God, I need wisdom to know what you want and how you want it to be done. And God will show you what he wants you to do. You'll have the knowledge of God in doing his will. So absolutely, it's his will. Next, you'll also understand righteousness. If you seek after wisdom, as if it's the most important thing, you'll gain righteousness. Verse 7, he layeth up sound wisdom for the righteous. Verse 9, then shalt thou understand righteousness. Then shalt thou, verse 9, then you will. Next, you'll also understand judgment, verse 9. You'll understand judgment. And number 5, you'll understand equity. You know what judgment is? Equity is equal, but judgment is fairness or what's right. God's justice and judgment are connected. But also, you'll understand equity. You'll know that God is just God. He is always right. And then number 6, you'll understand every good path. Verse 9 also says. So there's 6 things here we see. Then you will do these things or see these things and understand these things. Understand every good path. I remember as a young person wanting to understand the path that God had for me. Well, here's the answer. You want to understand your path, every good path? You'll get it when you seek after wisdom. So the more quickly you can learn that as a young person, the less pressure you'll have to find God's path. Just seek after wisdom. Seek after God, and he'll show it to you. All right, so if you do that, then you will. Why? Because, let me give you several reasons from the passage here. They're kind of scattered out. Because the Lord gives wisdom. Verse 6, for the Lord giveth wisdom. For, because. So if you'll seek after wisdom, you'll get it because the Lord gives it. Seek after the Lord. The Lord gives wisdom. Secondly, the Lord stores up wisdom for the right. He stores up wisdom. That verse, that word is found in verse 7. He layeth up sound wisdom for the righteous. Let me point out a couple thoughts there. You've heard of layaway. What is that? I've never used it.
It's whenever you can set something aside, the store will keep it for you until you have enough money to actually
pay for it. Sure. So you're right, to actually pay for it, right? To store it away. Okay? If I'm putting investment money away for retirement, we're laying aside some money. We're laying aside some money for later. That's exactly, it's talking about a storing or a storage of wisdom in this case. He layeth up sound wisdom for the righteous. He's putting away wisdom, and I'll clarify the next word also then. He's laying away wisdom for the righteous, extra wisdom. Then the word sound wisdom has the idea of extra good wisdom, not just even regular wisdom, but sound wisdom, extra good wisdom. like the difference between olive oil and virgin olive oil. It's good olive oil, but it's even better when it's virgin olive oil. Okay, so the Lord stores up good, the best wisdom for the righteous. Third, why? Because he is a handy shield. He is a buckler to them that walk uprightly. He's a buckler. That's a certain kind of shield. You know, the Lord protects us from so many dumb decisions, bad decisions, when we seek after wisdom. You know, as a young person, you're tempted to do things with friends that aren't right and aren't good. And because your parents seek after wisdom, and they teach you to seek after wisdom, you don't really even want those things. In our little Christian school growing up, we had friends who did a lot of real bad things in the Christian school. And our parents, you know, they and our pastor, they really, you know, emphasized to us what was important, you know, going into the ministry and being in full-time service and so on. Well, if you're going to be in full-time service, you don't want to throw your life away for a little party right now. So those things really didn't even appeal to us that much because of, you know, seeing the value of things. But God protects those who are wise. God protects those who seek after wisdom. He's a buckler, a shield, a certain kind of shield. Four, because the Lord gives wisdom, because the Lord stores up the best wisdom. Number three, he's a handy shield. Number four, he guards our decisions. He keepeth the paths of judgment, verse 8 says. He keepeth the paths of judgment. He guards our judgment call. He guards our decision. That word judgment there is not talking about he's keeping the paths of whipping you over the head. That judgment is talking about a good thing, that we have good judgment. And he keepeth the paths of judgment. And then lastly, he preserves the way of the saints. He takes charge of our way. He takes charge of our way, so our way is protected. I love the idea in the book of Proverbs of the way, and all through the Bible, the way. A way is a road. A way is a life road. A path that you are on, that you take. Somebody was just the other day, who was it? Somebody talking about dating or something. I think it was Pastor Dameron. And how when you're on the right way and she's on the right way, that God will put the right person in your way. So trust the Lord for that and be on the right way. And I think it's it applies here. God protects and puts, he takes charge of our way. All right, so it's worth having wisdom. Wisdom is well worth it in light of the things that we've talked about. So know God and understand righteous. That's a condition of wisdom. Secondly, rest of the chapter then deals with how to walk the right way. How to walk in the right way. Okay, you ready for this? I'm going to give you some more of these. First, capital letter A is when certain things we do. Number, or capital letter B is then we will have. Third, then, we're going to see for three purposes. And then, lastly, D, because. All right, so this is the way the book of Proverbs is often set up, a little bit different kind of points and outline, but that's the way it is, and it's a good. All right, so starting there in verse 10. When wisdom enters into thine heart and knowledge is pleasant unto thy soul. Now, the word then is not found in verse 11, but it could be right at the beginning. When wisdom is in your heart, knowledge is in your soul, then discretion shall preserve thee and understanding shall keep thee. Why? For three purposes, to deliver thee from the way of the evil man, so on like that. So that's the way it reads, and so we'll divide it up this way. All right, so I don't have as many points this time as I did the first one, but when wisdom enters your heart and your soul enjoys knowledge. Okay, the word there, when wisdom entereth into thine heart, that's pretty obvious. That's that receiving of wisdom into your heart and soul. But the interesting one here is that knowledge is pleasant unto thy soul. The idea of pleasant there is enjoyable, as I mentioned. When I sit down to a regular supper, I like the supper. It's good. You know, my wife made it. Whatever it is, yeah, almost always I'm like, wow, this is good. But there's a different level. In my thinking, in my imagination, for Thanksgiving Day lunch, that's just a totally different level. I have nothing but fond memories when I think of Thanksgiving Day lunch. I think of all the different kinds of food, potatoes, and just on and on, all the dark meat, turkey. I like the dark meat. Gravy, rolls, pies. I mean, all that's on a totally different level. no comparison, right? That is the pleasant that this is talking about. Knowledge is enjoyable unto thy soul. Do you enjoy knowledge? Or I think in our day and age, so many people's minds and souls really are just filled with blah, you know. Okay, I like a good movie, but then when you get done with it, okay, you know, what do you do with that? You know, what do you do with that? A good book is different than that. Because you're like, wow, man, okay. To me, a movie just kind of all runs together and the last thing you see is what you remember, kind of, for me. But a book, man, you can get, there's a lot of information. Wow, that was interesting. You're kind of thinking through the different things you read. Wow. Knowledge should be pleasant, enjoyable, really something special to our soul. How much do you put into your knowledge, learning knowledge? When wisdom enters your heart, knowledge is pleasant in your soul, then we'll have discretion and understanding. Discretion and understanding. Verse 11. Discretion shall preserve thee, understanding shall keep thee. We haven't looked at the word discretion yet, have we? I don't believe. What's the word discretion mean?
Ability to recognize between good and bad, and the best choice.
Okay. What is it? What's the root word of discretion?
Discerning.
It's not discerning.
Discreet.
Thank you. Discreet. Discreet. I'm not sure exactly the difference between discreet and discernment, because they are definitely related. But discernment has the idea of choosing between, I think, kind of between good and bad, or between good and better. Okay, so I'm actually, you know, good is here in the middle, between good and bad or good and better. So I think that's some of discernment. But discreet has even more, it's a more of a heart issue. Like discreet is more of an adjective describing your heart.
Knowing how to handle a delicate situation in the best way, type of thing.
Mm-hmm. That'd be part of it, yeah. I, for some reason, I don't have my definition with me on this one. I thought I had it here, but I don't have a meaning for the word discreet.
I just think of, you know, whenever you kind of step into a conversation,
yes,
and you discreetly turn away.
Sure. But it's definitely, it's to me, it's a heart attitude. It's something from within you that either you have it or you don't. It's not something really visible on the outside type thing. I'll see if I can get a meaning for that. All right, so if wisdom enters in our heart, knowledge is pleasant in our soul, then we'll have discretion and understanding for these purposes. All right, so let's look at verse 12. In order to deliver thee from the evil man. All right, let me give it to you this way. Three purposes are to deliver from the habits of evil people. There's several descriptions of this evil man, so we want to subcategorize these. But to deliver thee from the habits of evil people, the evil man is not just the male variety, it's an evil person. All right, so what kind of evil people? What do the evil people do? They speak froward things. They speak, the word froward is a word that we don't use much anymore. And there's all kinds of these words, aren't there? And you'll have lots of word meanings, I promise you. What does the word froward mean?
Perverse.
Thank you. You get it in your Bible? Perverse. The wicked man speaks perversely. Exactly right. Also, the wicked man, verse 13, they leave the paths of uprightness to walk in the ways of darkness. All right, so they leave the paths of the righteous. They quit walking with the righteous. That's what I have written down. Evil people don't walk with righteous people. Okay, so think about the practical nature of this. As you're walking down the way, the path, as you're walking on the path, there will be evil people with you. But as you stay on the path, they leave the paths of uprightness to walk in their own way of darkness. So you just stay on the path, and the path is the path of uprightness. They will leave you. And they can laugh at you, and they can knock you, and they can say all manner of evil things about you. But the bottom line is, if you're on that path and they leave, just keep right on going. Because they're the ones who won't walk with the righteous anymore. Number three, verse 14, who rejoice to do evil and delight in the frowardness, the perverseness of the wicked. They rejoice in sin and they enjoy other people's wickedness. Oh, I can't fathom the perverseness that's out there, even in, among conservative, so-called conservative Republicans. You know, I went to a CPAC once, and they just have to bring out, you know, some filthy joke, and everybody gets a big kick out of it. They're perverted, you know, they just have so many perverse ways. You know, it doesn't matter. Sorry, Mr. Alaska here, but I remember hearing, I can't repeat it, Sarah Palin, Christian, conservative, Tea Party, and just, she made a crude, filthy joke. Are you serious? Who rejoice in sin and enjoy other people's wickedness. You know, I don't know if she's saved or not, but I know she claims to be. But, all right. They rejoice in sin, they enjoy others' wickedness. And then number five, whose ways, verse 15, whose ways are crooked and they froward in their paths. See, they left the path of uprightness. You are walking down the path of uprightness. By the way, that path of uprightness is a direct route. There's nothing confusing about it. It's clear. Okay, it's straight. The Bible calls it a straight way often, a straight path. But the way of the evil man, they leave the straight path and they go off in a crooked path. In other words, you're going directly to where you need to go. They aren't going directly where they should be going. They're going off on this crooked path and wandering around, taking the scenic road, as we call it, taking the long road, wasting their life away. You are going directly on that path. It's a straight path. Okay, so that's another thing that they twist. Oh, I didn't give you the point that I have. You can write down how you want, but they twist the right way. They're crooked. The word crooked is twisted. I like that word. When I see something that's perverse or something like that, I like to call it twisted. That's twisted. What that means, that's not normal, that's not straight, that's not good, that's weird, it's bizarre, perverse, twisted. All right, so for three purposes. One is to deliver from the habits of evil people. These are the five things that we mentioned they do. Secondly, they deliver, wisdom delivers from immorality. Ooh, boy. Here's the first time in the book of Proverbs where we discuss immorality. And we've got to get moving, wow. But it's the first time where we discuss immorality. But immorality and wisdom do not go hand in hand. A person involved in immorality is foolish. And a person who is righteous is moral. And wise, a person who's wise is moral. So walking in the right way, wisdom delivers from immorality and immoral people. Look at verse 16. So we saw in verse 12, to deliver thee from the evil man. Now verse 16, to deliver thee from the strange woman. Okay, so before you get all proud saying, yeah, the strange woman. Yeah, see, she's the woman is referred to as the foreign. Strange literally means foreign. Woman with her ways, her gods, her sins. Well, it also talked about the evil man. Okay, so men and women are evil. And men and women are immoral, strange, as this is defined in verse 16. To deliver thee from the strange woman. And that strange woman literally is in reference to immorality. Even from the stranger which flattereth with her words. So let's describe some of the things that the immoral person does and that wisdom will deliver us from. The immoral person flatters with words. The strange woman which flattereth with her words. What else does she do? She rejects instruction. She forsakes the guide of her youth and forgets the covenant of her God. I don't care what people say. When you're young, you know, people know they're not supposed to be immoral. They just know that. It's in them from God. It's a covenant with God. You know that when you do those immoral things, you're purposely going against God. Guarantee you. And of course, being on, thankfully, having parents and family who taught me that, you know, I can easily say that that's true. I knew that it was wrong. Everybody knows that it's wrong, I believe. It's a covenant with God. Immorality, the immoral strange woman flatters with words. She rejects instruction. It leads to death. For her house inclineth unto death, and her paths unto the dead. Okay, here's the first time that the word incline comes up. I like this word. It's used in a good sense and in a bad sense. But obviously this is in a bad sense. Think about it. It's never good when a house is inclining. Right? When a house is leaning. Why does it say it? For her house inclineth unto death. What if you saw a house inclining over a cliff? Right? I wouldn't want to be there unless I knew a little secret, you know, that there's a very strong structure underneath that. Kind of like the Willis Tower nowadays with their glass floor. You know, that's pretty dumb, you know. I don't know. I've never been out there. I probably would do it if I was up there. Walk out on the glass floor. But it's because I know that that's not just normal glass, you know. That's really reinforced glass and so on. But if I see a house leaning over, it's inclining unto death, where is it eventually going to go? Over. It's a matter of time, right? And some people's lives, specifically with immorality, when they are loose and they dress a certain way, they are inclining that way. And where are they eventually going to go? I mean, it's just a matter of time. They're going over the cliff. So her house inclines not just to immorality, but immorality inclines unto death. Okay, you know, I know I'm on video and all, but the truth is that people who get killed in these huge protests and nightclubs, right? And all of these, you know, huge festivals, it's because they're inclining unto death. The things that they do lead them in the paths that take people that route. You know, so if you're on the road going to somewhere, you're eventually going to get there. So don't be surprised, because immorality leads to death. That's one of the results. That's one of the end products. So don't be surprised when it leads there. And don't be surprised when it gets you there earlier than you thought. For her house inclineth unto death, and her paths unto the dead. None that go unto her return again, neither take they hold of the paths of life. So immorality flatters with her words, rejects instruction, it leads to death, and fourth, it's irreparable. Cannot be repaired. Okay, this is not saying that nobody who is immoral can ever be used of God again. That's not what it's saying. But what it is saying is it's never the same. Immorality, once a person is immoral, it's just never the same. It can't be the same. It's broken. It's a vase that's broken. You can patch it, you can glue it, but it's never the same. There's different, anyway. Like a spring, there's an example. If you have a spring that's really powerful, you ever seen one of them real powerful? Well, once one of those is stretched out of out of whack, or that's the way I would describe it. One of those bars is stretched out the wrong way or bent. You'll never get it back exactly the same. And that's very true with immorality. We'll see that come up numerous other times here in Proverbs. All right, so I didn't give you the third purpose yet. To deliver thee from the evil man, verse 16, to deliver thee from the strange woman. And then look down at verse 20. Another purpose of walking in wisdom and wisdom entering in your heart. It'll not only deliver you from the evil man, deliver you from the strange woman, but it'll help you walk in the way of good men. Verse 20. So wisdom is good for helping you walk in the way of good men. The way of good men is the habits of good people. So remember a little bit ago I mentioned that as you're on this path, there will be some evil men on the path, but they leave. So as you keep on this path, there are many other good people walking with you. The evil people, they leave and head off and do their own thing on their crooked way. But there are always other good people who will help you. And I love being around good people. You ever meet, I don't know, when I see on TV or on the internet or something, these very wealthy people, and, you know, they can, even politicians, politicians are probably some of the worst, but TV stars and all this kind of stuff, and they act like, you know, they have life taken care of, and everybody should bow down and worship them pretty much. And I've often said to people, I guarantee you, nobody in their right mind will want to be around them. Because they're nasty people. They don't treat their friends nice, much less their enemies. they're just nasty people. They're mean. You know, these women, some of these women, you know, have the beautiful faces and so on, and are on TV for their looks. I mean, they are some of the creepiest, nastiest people, I'm sure, in real life. Foolish people. So I love being with good people. Just people who have normal desires and want to see their families and want to be with their kids. And, you know, oh my goodness, I'm so glad I'm a Christian and get to just be with good people. All right, so for the three purposes, to deliver from the evil people, deliver from immorality, and to walk in the habits of good people. Because two things. The upright will live in God's blessings. The upright shall dwell in the land, verse 21, and the perfect shall remain in it. I like being in the land of God. I like being in, let's see here, with the upright and the perfect. Because the upright live in God's blessing. And the second point is the other side of that coin. The wicked get cut off. I'd rather be with the upright. The wicked shall be cut off from the earth. Notice that the good and the bad, the upright and the wicked, both live in the land. But the upright stay, and the wicked are cut off. Let's think about this age-old question, though. Right now, it seems like the wicked are more secure in the land than we are. Boy, they don't worry about, well, on the surface, they don't worry about money. They have everything they could want. That's not true, but they act like they have everything they could want. Their life seems to be going good. But the truth is, they'll be cut off, and the upright are the ones who will still be going on. And so, you have to believe that by faith, but it is true. Okay, that's chapter 2. Ooh, wow, that went longer than I thought. Let's go to chapter 3. I'll go quickly, I promise. All right, the first 12 verses of chapter 3, actually, back up to the title. And here's the title of chapter 3. The wise shall inherit glory. The wise shall inherit glory. And I'll try not to tell as many stories or illustrations and things. All right, the first 12 verses are a pattern of the first verse with a command and the second verse with a reward. So a command and a reward. A command and a reward. That goes down through verses 1 through 12. Verse 3, chapter 3, verse 1. My son, forget not my law. There's the command. But let thine heart keep my commandments. For length of days, long life, and peace shall they add to thee. So let me give to you six comparisons, six sets of command and reward. So a command and a reward. So verses 1 and 2 tell us, don't forget God's law, you'll have long life and peace. Don't forget God's law, you'll have long life and peace. And that is so true. You stay in the law, you stay in the Word of God, and you'll have His peace and just a good life. Long life isn't necessarily the length as how many days you live, even though that's probably part of it, but it's also how good the quality of life, not just the quantity. So verses 1 and 2, don't forget God's law, you'll have long life and peace. Secondly, in verse 3, don't forsake mercy and truth, you'll have favor with God and man. Don't forsake mercy and truth, you'll have favor with God and man. God's a God of mercy and He's a God of truth. And if we receive that mercy and truth and then pass it along to our fellow man, I guarantee you're going to have favor with God and man. Favor with man. Third, verse number 5, don't trust your own understanding. You'll have God's direction. There's the reward. Don't trust your own understanding. You'll have God's direction. Here's our famous verses. Trust in the Lord with all thy heart, lean not unto thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge Him, and He shall direct thy paths. There's the reward. He'll direct your paths. You're young, all of you, and I am too, relatively speaking. But you're young, boy, you want God's direction. And make sure you're seeking after His direction. How do you do that? Trust in the Lord. With all thine heart, lean not to your own understanding. Don't plan your own life out. Let God plan your life out. Verse 7, don't be self-wise. You'll have a healthy stomach. Oh, look at that. Don't be self-wise. Be not wise in thine own eyes. Fear the Lord and depart from evil. It shall be health to thy navel. And marrow to thy bones. You realize you'll be healthy if you trust in the Lord, if you are not wise in your own eyes. I fully believe, I know there's people who are not healthy because of whatever, some other reason. But as a whole, if you fear the Lord and you do what's right, you'll be much, 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 much more healthy than if you don't. I think that's a standard. Very true, though. God made that promise, by the way, to the children of Israel, that if they would do certain things, none of these diseases, the diseases of Egypt, would not come upon them. And so, it's certainly health and serving God are related. And then next, number 5, the fifth one, which is verse number 9, honor the Lord. Let's put it this way. Put God first in your possessions, and you'll have plenty of food. Honor the Lord with thy substance, and with the first fruits of all thine increase, so shall thy barns be filled with plenty. And thy presses shall burst out with new grape juice, wine. And by the way, that wine there, that grape juice, is a refreshing thing. That's the way it's referring to. It's a refreshing thing. It's like sitting down on a hot day with a cold, drawn fresh out of the vat cup of grape juice. It's refreshing and gives you new energy. You know, it's not talking about wine in the sense we think of today as far as beer or fermented wine. It's not talking about that at all. And it's definitely not referring to Pepsi. So. Or Mountain Dew. Sweet tea. There you go. Yes. Very good. All right. And then verse number 11, we see the sixth benefit of wisdom. Don't despise God's correction. You'll receive his love. Think about that. Correction and love go hand in hand. My son, despise not the chastening of the Lord, neither be weary of his correction. For whom the Lord loveth, he correcteth, even as a father the son in whom he delighteth. So we see these patterns here. If you'll do this, there's a command and then a reward in the first 12 verses. Did I give you a heading for that section? I didn't give that to you. Okay, maybe put next to that, wisdom's benefits. I skipped over the main point there. So, what I have is getting wisdom's benefits. And that's my first main point for the chapter. All right, next we'll look at seeing wisdom's value. Yes, seeing wisdom's value. All right. What is wisdom? I don't know how to ask this, but the Bible tells us that wisdom is more value than some things. And there's many things that wisdom is compared to as being more valuable than. So we see that wisdom is very precious. Look at verse 13. Happy is the man that getteth wisdom. All right, so you'll be happy if you get wisdom, the Bible tells us. Happiness is one of the first values of wisdom. I like being happy. Of course, this is not just a cheap happiness, silly laughter, but it's having a true, I think in this sense, a true joy about things. Just having a general good disposition, verse 13. Verse 14, for the merchandise of it is better than the merchandise of silver, and the gain thereof than fine gold. Wisdom is more valuable than precious metals. I can have silver or gold, and I'd be much better off if I had no silver and gold and instead had wisdom. So wisdom's value is that it brings happiness. It gives you more than precious metals. It's more valuable. It brings fulfillment. I can't think of anything I'd rather have when I'm 80 years old than fulfillment. I did something good in my life. I can't think of anything I'd rather have when I'm 50, which is only 10 years away. I can't think of anything I'd rather have when I'm 40, which is right now, than fulfillment, knowing that my life is accomplishing something, has some purpose. Fulfillment. Next, wisdom also is valuable because it gives long life. What do you have that's more important than your life? Right? Length of days is in her right hand. Your life, wisdom is brings you life. Wisdom is valuable. It brings honor and riches. In her left hand, riches and honor. Rick, are you a lefty?
No.
Good. So we're all righties here. Notice in that verse what's more important. Length of day, verse 16. Length of days is in her right hand, and in her left hand, riches and honor. It's not an accident, I don't believe. And I'm not saying, dumb left-handers. But as it's always been understood, the right hand is stronger and better than the left hand. I mean, look where Jesus is sitting. It's not the left hand of the Father. Seriously, that is the way it's always been viewed historically. Okay, peace and pleasantness. Wisdom's value, it brings peace and pleasantness. Her ways are ways of pleasantness, and all her paths are peace. I like it. And then lastly, happiness again. Wisdom's value brings happiness. She is a tree of life to everyone that lay hold upon her, to them that lay hold upon her, and happy is everyone that retaineth her. Happiness. All right, so we see that wisdom has value. Thirdly, then, let's point out that we want to find wisdom's uses. Finding wisdom's uses. All right, what is wisdom used for? Now, there's two aspects here in this chapter that wisdom is used for. One is from God's aspect, and the other one is from man. So let's see what God did with his wisdom. Verse 19. The Lord by wisdom hath three things. He founded the earth, he made the heavens, and he designed the water cycle. That's not what the Bible, how it says it, but that's what it is. Verse 19 and 20. He founded the earth, he made the heavens. Man, how complicated are all of these things. And then verse 20, he designed the water cycle. By his knowledge, the depths are broken up and the clouds drop down the dew. There it is, the water cycle. God used wisdom, vast, infinite wisdom in these areas. Founding the earth, the heavens, and the water. I mean, just in those three things, you know, obviously they're big, really big. He has showed his wisdom. Now, what is man's use of wisdom? Verse 21. My son, let not them depart from thine eyes. Keep sound wisdom and discretion. So shall they be life unto thy soul and grace to them. Let me give you some of man's uses. First of all, is life. In wisdom, you get life. In wisdom, you also get grace to thy neck. Then shalt thou, in verse 23, walk in thy way safely. Safety. And then, verse 24, when thou liest down, thou shalt not be afraid, yet thou shalt lie down, thy sleep shall be sweet rest. So you get life, grace, safety, and rest in using wisdom. Hey, if God can use wisdom to make the earth and the heavens, then we ought to use wisdom on our side. Okay, now the last section of this chapter I'm calling rejecting unwise actions. So we saw getting wisdom's benefits, seeing wisdom's value, finding wisdom's uses. Now let's see how to reject and what happens when you reject unwise actions. 25 to 35. There's some actions to reject, and there's some reasons to reject. Let me give you these real quickly. Some actions to reject. Fear. Reject fear, verse 25. Be not afraid of sudden fear. How do you be afraid of afraid? Don't be afraid of fear. Listen, you all fear things, right? When you're rock climbing, you fear. You too, both of you. When you're rock climbing, you fear. Don't be afraid of fear itself. Fear will come, but don't be afraid of it. So reject nervous fear. Also reject, actions to reject, attacks from the wicked. These are actions to reject. So we shouldn't, we should reject fearing attacks from the wicked. Verse 25, be not afraid of sudden fear, neither, don't be afraid of, the desolation of the wicked. The attacks from the wicked, don't be afraid of those. Another action to reject, withholding good. Verse 27 and 28, reject it, withholding good. In other words, do good. Also, verse 29, reject scheming against a neighbor. Reject scheming. You can see these are kind of broad, just kind of random things. But these are all unwise actions to reject. Fighting without a cause, verse 30. Strive not with a man without cause. It's a good verse for your roommate, right? Or your wife. But usually there's a cause, right? Especially with your wife. And reject fighting without a cause. Verse 31, reject envying the bully. Envy thou not the oppressor, the bully, the guy who's out looking for a fight. Don't envy the bully. Actions to reject. Secondly, reasons to reject. Why should you reject these unwise actions? Because God will protect us, and God's going to take care of the bully himself. Verse 33 and 34 tell us that God actually curses the wicked. He'll take care of it. Don't be afraid of the attacks of the wicked. God will take care of the wicked himself. Verse 33 and 34, God despises the oppressor. The froward, verse 32, is abomination to the Lord. But his secret is with the righteous. And listen, I challenge you not to be unwise and not to be afraid of those who are unwise, not to be afraid of those who are against God because of what we talked about earlier. In the long run, in the long term, we will see the Lord victorious over those things and over those oppressors and over those, as I call them, bullies. It's not really a very popular term these days, but... Okay, we'll stop there.